So, hello everyone. I'm Brian. You might know me from the internet. I work at Google on the AngularJS core team, and today I'm going to talk about tools. This is cool. Okay. But before I do that, I'm going to talk a little bit about documentation. Documentation is like the most simple tool that you have as a developer. So sometimes you don't know what's happening and you might open up your debugger. Sometimes you don't know what's happening and you go to documentation. So like my vague definition of tool is thing that you go to and you don't know what's happening. I think documentation is actually kind of underutilized, and so I'm going to try and impress this like philosophical idea upon you, and hopefully this is something that you can use in your own software. So we've written a lot of docs for Angular. They used to be much worse than they are now, but there's a lot of them, and this is both good and bad. Our docs are very thorough now, but it's also not obvious where to go to find something. So we still get a lot of questions about Angular, things on GitHub that maybe the docs could answer. And so you might be tempted to give a response like this, like RTFM. So if you're not familiar with this phrase, it means read the effing manual. And this is kind of entirely a wrong idea, in my opinion. First off, it assumes that the person hasn't read the manual. There's a lot of manual if you make anything interesting, right? So a lot of you author various Angular components. And I've read them. I've read through them. And there's lots of docs. And sometimes it's not obvious where to look for something. Sometimes you're using an outdated version or a version that doesn't match with the version of the docs that you're looking at. There are all sorts of things, and I think that it would be nice if there was a better way to get to the thing in the doc that you really care about. So I'll come back to that idea in a bit. But first, there are two kind of cases that I think are really frustrating in software. One of them is where you do something, and then like nothing happens, and like you expected something to happen, like you expected the button to turn blue, or you expected something to shoot across the screen, you expected a cute sound effect to play, and nothing happened at all. And the second one that I think is really frustrating is when you accidentally like code yourself into a corner because you just didn't know better. And if only you had this vital piece of information like, you know, a week ago, you could save yourself months of time. So the first one, when nothing happens, compared to the case when like the wrong thing happens, you might imagine you have like a stack trace or you have you know, some variable that you can watch. You have something, some breadcrumb that leads you back to the source or the cause of what's causing you issues. With this, you have nothing, right? Your best bet is to like put some assertion or some log in the middle of your stack of software and try and like binary search your way to the part that actually matters. This is really frustrating and requires lots of like context switching and does these terrible things to your brain and makes you sad. So it's really cool if we can reduce this. Here's a cool example of this happening in Angular, right? So can you guys figure out why this doesn't work? Yeah? There's no such thing as ng-clock. That's not real. But it's not obvious to see this in a bunch of lines of code, and when you go to click this button, it's not necessarily obvious whether there's a bug in your controller or some service that it depends on or whether, you know, your server is timing out or if you misspelled the word click or what, right? And it would be good if you had some sort of feedback, right? That would be awesome. Let's think about a case where you didn't know any better, right? I think a common one in Angular is kind of where you manipulate the DOM, right? So a beginner might be tempted to put stuff in their controller that doesn't really belong there, and then they, you know, make some project of medium complexity and realize that, oh, like this won't compose well with anything else. And so this is really talking about best practices. And personally, I think like best practice docs and like style guides and this sort of thing are great, but they're also kind of terrible from like an end user's perspective, right? It's kind of like a list of trivia. And it's not really obvious when this will be useful or how. And unless you've been doing a lot of work with some piece of software, you might not even recognize all these terms or be able to apply it. A lot of best practices are best practice guides are really aimed at newcomers as well, and I think they have a hard time kind of finding things within there. So you might say like, oh, well, just categorize it better or just index it better somehow. But I don't think that, that really helps, because a lot of the time, you know, you can't just put something into some nice, neat hierarchy. And sometimes you can't order it in a way that matches kind of the order of things that a developer starting to use a piece of technology is going to do. So one concrete example of this in Angular is, like I said before, when you grab some element inside your controller and you're doing things to it, right? So, like, can we do any better? Yes, there are actually like semi-obvious solutions to this, right? So we can check all of the attributes of all compiled elements against a list of all of the directives that Angular ever expects to see whenever you compile something, right? So then we could, you know, use something like autocorrect, like one of these algorithms, the same sort of thing that you see on your phone, and say, oh, ng clock, do you mean ng click? And similarly, there are some kind of terrible tricks that you can do to figure out whether or not things are happening inside of your controller related to DOM manipulation. I won't get into the implementation of that because it's a little bit scary and probably would upset you. But the problem here, which should be obvious, is that for like end users of your application, you're introducing a bunch of runtime overhead, right? So Angular in its core can't really just add these sort of features. Right, like this would make everything really, really slow. And you might say, well, why don't you just, you know, disable these things with a flag? And that's still frustrating because now you have all of these extra bytes that had to come down the wire for this, right? Like a list of all the directives, that's a lot. Okay, so like what is the solution? How can we solve this? So one of the cool things in Angular is it has this nice DI system. And what that lets you do is you can decorate existing components. So what if we just had separate components that you could load in that add these sort of checks at runtime, and then you can develop with them? And so, like, yeah, that was a good idea. So the way I went about this was I got interns, and I was like, hey, you guys want to make this thing? And they said yes, because they had to. And so what came out of it, this is Carlos and Aaron, by the way. Thank you, Carlos and Aaron, for making the crazy thing that I told you to this summer. Really appreciate it. So the thing that they made was Angular Hint. And Angular Hint works like this, right? You just add ng hint as a module in your app, and suddenly you get these assertions. It is on GitHub, and it's pretty well documented. And it looks like this, right? So in our example before, we had this ng clock thing. And this can tell you, oh, look, it's at this line, and maybe you want to do this. And this could save you maybe an hour of debugging, right? Worst case, if you're really not able to track this down. So this is convenient, but there are a bunch of other places that you can apply this, right? So one other thing that commonly happens is you want to use like ng-route or, you know, probably UI-router, right? So you add the script tag, but you forgot to actually add the module, right? So you can get a warning for something like this. This is another one of these errors in the class of, like, just why doesn't it work? Like, just nothing happens. You can also know about APIs that we've removed, right? This is another kind of frustrating thing, and something that you could say, oh, well, you know, end user, your job is to read the change log and make sure that you know about all of the breaking changes. But maybe they're referencing a different version of the Angular docs, or maybe they're in the process of updating, and you know they're going through each of the things in this change log and trying to adapt to it, but they haven't gotten around to this particular one yet. And so two examples in recent memory are we removed this ability to load controllers that are just globals on window, because that's a bad idea. And we also removed ng-bind HTML unsafe. Instead, now we have the strict contextual scaping. And so there's a different API for this. But this is frustrating because if you're reading an old version of the docs, you might try and use this directive, and again, you'll just have nothing happen. And it won't be obvious why. So this is cool because you have an opportunity now to say, oh, well, we removed this API. You should go look at the change log. And also, the user might realize, oh, like, I'm totally looking at the wrong version of the docs. And this might lead them to understand more things about why something in their app isn't working. Another thing, this is kind of the, you know, preventing yourself from writing yourself into a corner. You have these kind of best practices around naming. So controller should start with a capital letter, which it seems kind of silly, but it's important to know that they're a class, and this becomes more intuitive as you use them. Another similar thing is it's important to kind of namespace or prefix your directives, so that way you don't clash, at least for now, in any other 1.3. So these are, again, things that are not obvious, and you'll have a correct working program, but later it might be a pain to have to undo this work. So there are actually like a ton more features, but like they're kind of boring like this, and it's not something that you can really appreciate until you use it and you realize like, oh, I almost shot myself in the foot there, but this saved me. And the exciting thing about this is like you can also write your own hints like this. So again, I know a lot of you are authors of components because I talk to you and ask you questions about them and stuff. And one thing that you can do is just provide an additional module that does expensive runtime checks, or more expensive runtime checks that only a developer would necessarily care about. And I think that this is a huge win if you're writing anything reusable, in that you can reduce the number of times that you get asked the same question on GitHub, or at least that's my hope. So we'll see if that actually kind of pans out. So I talked a little bit about this technique. This is what the code actually looks like. It's pretty simple. What this does is it asks for the original dollar controller service, and then you can do stuff to it and return a new dollar controller service that, for instance, knows to check names of things, or it knows to check whether or not you're doing DOM manipulations or something like this. And I think this is also cool in that you can use it in your like CI environment, right? So you can have Protractor load this up and run it. And so for onboarding people in your team, maybe you have some custom conventions or some custom way that you organize code, you can write checks like this and kind of have a little bit more automated of a code review, right? I know a lot of people in their CI environments run things like JSLint that know how to take care of like simple code styling things. But this can actually catch a bunch of things in advance and kind of save you a bunch of time. Okay, so I told people that there's going to be a new Batarang. This was the cutest picture of a bat that I could find on the internet this morning. And this is what the new Batarang looks like. So it's like much simplified, and it actually works this time, and it's fast, and it's really cool. Check it out. It's on GitHub as well. The other cool thing about it is that it integrates with this Angular hint thing. So rather than like, you know, download this file and have to like wire it into your app, you can just do this and it'll find your app and it'll give you all of these sort of hints in there, and you can check it out. Okay, so there's a bunch of things that I want to do in the future. One of them is give you performance hints. So for instance, if you have some really expensive watch that you set up, it can let you know ahead of time before, you know, maybe you load in a full data set. So even when you're developing with like 10 rows of data, it can say, oh, this is like substantially more expensive, and then you can fix it before you're loading like full production data sets or something. And then I also want something that can help you migrate, right? So you're running Angular 1.2, and there are a bunch of various changes to get you to 1.3. It would be cool if you could detect them and point to the specific spots in the docs where things changed. And I want someone to make something like this. So I want to take the hints and have them appear in my text editor with like a little squiggly under them. I think that would be really cool, but I'm not going to make this. So that's all I have. Thank you so much. There's the slides as well.